Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents House of Rejoicing by Libbie Hawker, narrated by Heather Wilds. The names of the sacred cattle are the House of Cars, Mistress of All, Silent One who dwells in her place, She of Chemis, whom the god ennobled, the much-beloved Red of Hair, She who protects in life, the party-colored, She whose name has power in her craft, Storm in the Sky, who holds the god aloft, the Bull, the husband of the cows, the Book of the Dead, Spell 148. Unkesanamen, Year 1 of Horemheb, Holy are the manifestations, chosen of Re. There are many who say that I have no voice. Still more would claim that I do not have a thoughtful heart. They think a woman who keeps quiet must be simple. They think that my eyes have forever been on the floor, shy, like a gazelle among the thorns. They do not suspect that I know when to look up, that when their eyes are turned away, that is when I see. It is true that the gods, and there are many gods, I know, never blessed me with boldness. It is true that I haven't my mother's beauty. I cannot stand before a crowd and know that they will love me as she could do. I haven't the pluck of my eldest sister, nor my father's fatal focus, nor the silent, watchful certainty of my grandmother. I haven't the buoyant, trusting charm of my brother, my dear brother, whom I loved so well. They are all with you now, Wassa. O merciful God of the dead, I know that you live, that you have ever been, that you and all the gods of Egypt will take your rightful places once more. I know, too, that I will not live to see that glorious day. I am what the gods have made me, the watcher in the shadows, the eye that sees the whole world. I have looked on as, one after another, my family has fallen. I am the last of my line, and perhaps that is for the best. But soon I must fall too. There is no fear in my heart, only quiet determination. As the last small drop in a bloodline of reckless divinity, I cannot help but feel as if I must bear all their sins upon my back, that I must carry the blame for all the darkness my family has cast upon the world. It is I who will be called to account, who will stand in the underworld caverns of the Duat and answer to the gods for all my family's crimes. Goddess Iset, you who know all names, you know my Ren, the name of my heart. You know that when I was shaped on the divine potter's wheel, I was given but little voice. My voice is not in my throat, but in my writing brush, and what trouble my writing brush has wrought for me. I have sealed my fate with a letter. So now, if you are willing, Iset, let me salvage my afterlife with the words I write. I will tell you, whoever you are, whoever comes to find these papyri when I am gone, everything I know of my family. I will tell it full, and tell it true, and hope that it is enough to rinse their sins from my soul. For on the day when I stand before Anupu, when he places my heart on the scales of judgment to weigh it against the feather of truth, I must be cleansed of my family's stain. I must speak these words with a clear conscience. I have not done crimes against the people. I have not sinned in the place of truth. I have not known what should never be known. I have not harmed any man. I have not blasphemed a god, nor done what the god abhors. I have not caused pain. I have not caused tears. I have not killed, nor ordered any killing. I have not made anyone to suffer. I have not stopped a god in his procession. I am pure. I am pure as the heron of Henes. You might ask, how can she know these things? How can she tell of deeds that happened when she was a child, even before her birth, and claim that she speaks the truth? I can answer you in one way only. It is often the silent ones who see the most, who think the deepest, who observe. If a woman speaks but little, then she has more time to listen. And in my short life, I have heard many tales from those who know the truth. So now hear the truth. Hear all who came before me, speaking with the tongue of this scroll. Let me be cleansed before death comes to claim me. Let me read my name in the book of coming forth by day. Let all be known. Let me not add to the weight of the balance, nor falsify the plummet of the scales. Let me walk in the fields of reeds forever. Kiya, year 36 of Amenhotep, ruler of Waset, lord of truth in the sun, strong bull arising. Her goods preceded her into the city, the flat, sun-baked, clamoring city. Although the princess of Mitanni remained aboard her ship, watching from a strange detached distance as the wealth of her dowry flowed down the ramp and onto the shore, the air was not perfumed with the river's gentle clarity. It smelled of city life. It stank. Egypt reeked of sweat, of anger, of the desperation that comes when men live atop one another like beasts in a narrow pen. She had smelled it for days as the ship made its way down the long silver stretch of the river, the bright, pure scent of open water gradually giving way to the reek of this far-off land. The city stank of beer and the cheap perfume of whores, of fish rotting in the unforgiving sun, of the waste of animals and men. She struggled to keep her hand still, hidden in her heavy, tasseled sleeves, so she would not pinch her nostrils shut and betray her true feelings for all to see. She watched the procession of her dowry wind from the docks up toward a broad stone-paved lane, which was flanked by tall, narrow mud-brick houses, the colour of sun-bleached hides. The houses seemed to lean inward, to press upon one another's shoulders, just as the Egyptians did in the alleys below, struggling to gain a better view of the princess's goods. From the foot of the ship's ramp, all along the great processional way, the road was lined with ranks of the pharaoh's soldiers, dressed in the striped blue and white kilts of their trade. Their belts were heavy with blades. Each man was armed with a long spear and adorned by a single small round shield. The soldiers held their bucklers across their naked well-browned chests. The shields were set with bronze studs, polished and slicked by the blows of swords. They glimmered in the sunlight, so that they looked like suns themselves, like twin riverbanks made of little suns fallen to the earth. Riverbanks, between which all the princess's possessions were drifting steadily away. First went the fine textiles, so that they would not be soiled by the dust of the procession. Her light silk gowns and woolen robes with heavy layered skirts of many coloured tassels. Next went her jewels, displayed in open cedar cases, so that all the king's subjects might gape and admire. Ebony furniture for her house, furniture she would never be allowed to use, she felt certain, and mirrors of silver and copper, a golden spindle and distaff that were more beautiful than utilitarian, drinking vessels set with agates and platters inlaid with turquoise. A camel carried a fine litter balanced on its hump. The Egyptians pointed and cheered at this oddity, and a golden war chariot, drawn by two equally golden stallions, burnished and prancing, with floating manes as pale and airy as undyed fine-woven linen. Last, the procession was joined by dozens of slaves, and nearly as many free servants, who were nevertheless not so free that they might refuse to accompany their mistress to Egypt, never to see the hills and fragrant coastal forests of Mitanni again. Each was dressed in a silk robe, and the slaves carried themselves straight-backed and sure, for they at least knew their work and their purpose. Even the slaves looked infinitely more confident than the princess felt. She watched, silent and trembling, as the last of her servants steadied themselves on the ship's ramp and prepared to descend into the midst of this new land, into the stink and the clamour. the press of bodies half undressed, with their strange kilts of linen swinging loose around their knees and their backs bared to the heat. This was Waset, the grandest city in all the world. It was her home now, by her father's decree. This was to be her place in the world for all the days to come, until the end of her life. A team of litter bearers readied the double-chaired platform that would carry her to her husband. The last servant on the ramp, a girl the princess's own age, hesitated and turned back. The sun was bright on her braid, hair the color of newly founded bronze, like the princess's own. And for a fleeting moment, before the servant controlled her face with a professional will beyond her years, the princess noted hesitation and fear in the girl's green eyes and on her tight-pressed mouth. The princess stepped toward her litter, for there was nothing else to be done, no direction to go but forward. But the servant girl cried, "Wait!" and rushed to her side. The princess of Mitanni watched as her servant pummeled and fluffed the chair's cushions. "You should be comfortable on your wedding day, Lady Taduk Keeper," the servant said. She bowed, and when she bobbed up again, she was smiling. One of her front teeth was gone, knocked out, Taduk Keeper imagined, by an angry father or a jealous lover. Was that how the girl had found herself in this predicament? Part of Taduk Keeper's entourage, serving in a foreign land, a virtual exile. The missing tooth marred the girl's beauty, but not her warmth. Taduk Keeper smiled back at her. "What is your name, please?" she asked quietly, as she settled onto the cushions. The servant dropped her eyes. "My mother called me Inanna, after the goddess. It's a silly name for one such as I. I am not worthy of it." The words lisped slightly through the gap in her teeth. "I like your name." Taduk Keeper took her hand, a brief expression of thanks. Inanna's hand was warm, and Taduk Keeper's fingers burned suddenly in the girl's grip. Despite the heat of Egypt and the weight of her Hurrian robes, fear had chilled the princess to her bones. "Won't you please call me Nan, then?" the servant said, squeezing Taduk Keeper's hand. "Stay beside my litter," Taduk Keeper whispered to Nan. "I would have someone close, someone who does not make me feel afraid in this strange new place." She did not dare to speak her fears aloud. The priest of Ishtar came forward, muttering his prayers as he cradled the golden statue of the goddess close to his chest. The 8-pointed star tied to his forehead sent a flash of blinding light into Taduk Keeper's eyes. She blinked rapidly as the priest set the goddess on the chair to her right. Then, when her dazzled tears were gone, she risked a sidelong glance at the goddess, standing tall upon her sharp, taloned eagle's feet, her wings falling down her back like a cloak. Ishtar looked unafraid, but then statues always looked unafraid. Taduk Keeper swallowed hard and nodded to her litter-bearers. They lifted the platform onto their shoulders. The litter, decorated with strings of bells and tassels of beads, made a cheerful music as it descended the ramp. But when it reached the flat stone of the processional way, one bearer stumbled, only for a moment, and he caught himself at once, but it was enough to make Taduk Keeper's heart leap and to rock Ishtar perilously in her seat. Taduk Keeper reached for the goddess in a panic, fumbling to right her, and then she flushed. Was it ill luck to touch the goddess in this way, or good luck? She could not decide, and not knowing made her sick with worry. She kissed both her hands to take in the goddess's blessing, if indeed a blessing had been conferred, and to apologize if she had caused offense. From the height of her bearer's shoulders, Taduk Keeper looked down on the citizens of Waset. Men and women alike glanced up at her with minimal interest, their curiosity waning now that the last of her treasures had passed. Their glances were cynical. Some eyes even looked pitying in their stark rings of black coal. Some turned away before her litter had reached them, finding the dull daily work that waited in the bread and beer shops or at the stinking dockside far more interesting than the king's latest bride. Taduk Keeper was glad she had commanded Nan to stay close. The girl's presence was the one familiar thing to which she could hold in a world that saw her as nothing remarkable. Just another woman for the king, one of a great many. Taduk Keeper had known what these Egyptian rulers were like from her earliest days. she'd heard tales of King Amunhotep at her nurse's knee. The pharaoh had several palaces full of women she knew. So many women that he could never visit them all, never sire even one child on each of them, and the poor creatures were fated to live and age and die untouched and unloved, locked away in the gilded cages of the royal harem. As a child, these lurid tales of Egyptian proclivities had amused her, filling her with a pleasant kind of disbelief, a bubbling, mischievous shock. When she had reached her 17th year, and her father had called her to his throne room to announce that she would go to Egypt as a bride, as a pawn to maintain the fragile peace between Egypt and Mitanni, all the pleasure of the stories had shattered, and she had fallen to her knees, weeping shamefully before the eyes of the Hurrian court, pleading for mercy. But her father had refused to hear her cries, and for weeks afterward, as she prepared for the journey, no matter where she looked, her vision was obscured by the floating faint suggestion of the bars of a fine golden cage. By the time the procession reached the temple complex on the northern edge of the city, Tadu Kipa had allowed a haze to fall across her senses, a misty half-awareness through which reality filtered slowly, the throbbing heat, the sweat trickling down the back of her neck, Ishtar's cool composure, and the crowds turning away. As if she saw it all through the weave of a thick veil, a small gasp of shock from Nan, who walked close beside the litter, brought Tadu Kipa out of her miserable reverie. She looked up, eyes focusing for the first time since leaving the lower city. The gateway to the temple district rose above her, two soaring solid pylons of golden-hued limestone. They were stern and imposing, in true Egyptian style, blocky and slanted faintly inward like the sides of the great pyramids far to the north, which Tadu Kipa had observed several days ago from the deck of her ship as she had sailed past. The pylons stretched into the hot, blue-white sky. They were the height of 6 or 7 men at least, and every surface, every enormous block was carved and inscribed with the images of kings from generations gone. They surrounded her, frozen in postures of striding might, lifting clubs against enemies, holding doomed transgressors tight by the hair, driving their chariots into the sun. And all around the king's bodies, the strange illustrative characters of the Egyptian sacred script read them like Ishtar's protective power. Tadu Kipa could not read the sacred script. Its precise, carefully incised rows of birds and snakes, human figures and flowers were a mystery to her. She had only just gained the smallest understanding of Low Egyptian writing, the characters used for everyday communication. But she did not need to read the words to know that this towering gateway admitted her into a place of great and fearsome power. She could sense its import, could feel it bearing down upon her as if, like a thinking creature of malignant will, it sought to sweep her from her litter and cast her small, unworthy body into the dust. She glanced down at Nan, tempted to reach for the girl's hand again, but she would only look graceless and cowardly, leaning from her litter to cling to a servant's paw. And so she folded her hands firmly in her lap and sat up straight on her cushions, gazing straight ahead as the litter bore her into the city of temples. Once beyond the imposing gate, temples seemed to crowd all around her, small red granite shrines, their lintels carved with winged scarabs, larger houses dedicated to this god or that, with porticos framed by bright painted pillars. Strange stone beasts crouched on limestone plinths along the processional way, their human faces watching her with icy judgment above the live leonine bodies. In the distance, a low broad stair led to the massive pillars and yawning black entrance of a huge stone temple, larger by far than the rest. Tadu Kipa could see her dowry procession making its way up that stair, into that blackness, and she knew that she must follow. She swallowed the lump in her throat and clasped her hands together to still their trembling. The litter proceeded up the broad staircase. Nan puffed slightly as she climbed and wiped the sweat from her brow with a thin, pale wrist. The blackness at the temple's mouth at least provided relief from the heat, cool and sudden as a springtime rain in the mountains. It nearly made Tadu Kipa gasp aloud. She breathed deeply as the litter sank to the ground, allowing the shade's caress to soothe her, and smelled the thick, sweet odor of incense and the raspy char of burnt meat. Nan shuffled close as Tadukeeper stood. The servant girl offered her hand and guided Tadukeeper from the litter's platform. "It's so dark here," Tadukeeper said. Nan whispered back, "What is this place?" Two of Tadukeeper's other servants emerged from among the umber pillars. They lifted the goddess with reverence from her seat, then disappeared again into the shadows. As the litter was carried away, the darkness slowly receded. It was evident now that some flickering, shifting light source, torches perhaps, burned deep in the temple's heart. A long, wavering tunnel of faint orange light seemed to reach for Tadukeeper, extending toward her out of a blackness that was as deep and bottomless as the underworld. She gasped and clung to Nan's arm, heedless now of showing weakness or fear. She was afraid. Afraid and alone, save for her servant, who was trembling as much as Tadukeeper. A quiet ripple of voices drifted down the tunnel of light. A man's voice, deep, but with an animation that spoke clearly of his youth, and the high, light, musical laughter of a woman. A moment later, she heard footsteps, the soft scrape of sandals against stone, a confident, unhurried tread. Their linen garb was so brightly bleached that it emerged first from the darkness. Tadukeeper blinked at the bobbing shapes, swathes of fabric lightening from grey to a white tinted strongly by the orange light that trembled behind them. Then she saw their forms, the perfect smooth curves of the woman, her graceful almost dancing movements, and the silhouette of the man's body, broad through the shoulders, tall for an Egyptian, his legs as strong and straight as pillars. His head darted as he looked from Tadukeeper to Nan and back again. The locks of his short wig seemed to separate and settle again, like the feathers of a blackbird ruffling. Tadukeeper stepped away from Nan, forcing herself to stand alone under the man's scrutiny. Was this the king, then? The pharaoh whom she was to marry? The two figures drew close enough that she could at last make out their faces. They were beautiful, both so beautiful that their perfection struck her with a deep, icy dismay. And she had the peculiar sense that she had travelled not to a land inhabited by mortals, but into the realm of spirits and gods. The man's face was strong, his chin and jaw well angled, his nose was long and prominent, but it did not overwhelm his face, and his lips were full and curving, indicating Kushite heritage. He had deep-set, very dark eyes, the kind of eyes that could look stern, even naturally angry. But they took in Tadukeeper's face with a soft glow of pleasure, and as he looked at her, she felt some of her fear abate. No, this was not her husband. She knew that much as she offered him a feeble smile. This man was certainly too young to be the pharaoh. He could not have been more than 19 or 20, barely older than Tadukeeper herself, and the current pharaoh had sat on his throne for longer than that. The prince... Tadukeeper felt instinctively that he was a prince, if not a king. What else could such a fine, supremely self-assured man be? Smiled broadly and dipped his head in welcome. No lines marred the skin around his eyes. He was youthful indeed. The woman said something in her native tongue, and Tadukeeper blinked, tearing her gaze from the prince, struggling to comprehend the words. Although she had been tutored thoroughly in the Egyptian language, all understanding fled from her when she met the woman's eyes. She was lovelier than any woman Tadukeeper had seen, with a face that seemed carved by the finest sculptor, every stroke of bone and flesh made with fastidious care. She was a being of perfect balance, her breasts neither small nor large, but as round and appealing as sweet fruits, her waist slim and her hips neatly curved, supple shoulders giving rise to a long, graceful neck. And her face, not even the goddess Ishtar could claim such flawless, frightening beauty. Wide cheekbones framed a small Greek nose, and lips nearly as full as the prince's. The long, careful curls of her wig fell like dark water to her waist, and eyes the colour of tilled earth gazed at Tadukeeper with patient, faintly amused expression.
I'm sorry.
Tadukeeper stammered in Hurrian, the language of her homeland. Faced with such impossible beauty, every word of the Egyptian tongue escaped her mind. The prince gave a low, gentle laugh. She asked, he said in heavily accented Hurrian, "What is your name?" Tadukeeper gaped at him. She had not expected anyone in this country to speak Hurrian. Nan gave her a subtle nudge with her elbow, and Taru Keeper finally spilled out her name. The lovely woman made a show of tilting her head, as if she could not hear the response. Then her perfect mouth moved, trying out the Hurrian syllables. Tadu, Tadu, the woman said, and her eyes sparked with a quick, fierce light. Mockery, Tadu Keeper realized, withering inside. The woman tried one more time. Tadu Kiya, she laughed musically and shrugged her smooth shoulders. The prince gave his companion a tight, uncomfortable smile. Tadu Keeper, he corrected without difficulty. The beautiful woman tossed her head and turned away, back toward the temple's faintly glowing heart. Then she called over her shoulder in perfect Hurrian, "Come along, Tadu Kiya," and swept into the darkness. Tadu Keeper shared an uneasy glance with Nan. The servant's face was as pale as bread dough, even in the temple's dim interior. Then the prince stepped forward, offering his arm. "That was the Lady Nefertiti," he said. "I'm afraid she has a cutting wit to balance out her lovely looks. You mustn't mind her. She is only jealous." "Jealous?" Tadu Keeper said, taking the prince's arm with a trembling, hesitant hand. "Why?"
"Because you are the king's wife now, of course, or you will be as soon as you marry my father. Nefertiti is only a lady of the courts, and also she envies you because you are very beautiful."
Tadu Keeper flushed. Her thick wool robes were entirely too close and prickled against her heated skin. "Thank you," she said meekly. "What is your name, please, prince?"
The prince chuckled. "That is a strange word, prince. What does it mean? I should know it, I'm sure, but my tutors always had to scold to make me practice my Hurrian."
She blinked up at him in surprise, so startled that she did not notice the temple growing cooler as they moved into its depths, nor did she notice the rows of bronze bowls that lined its thick, smoke-darkened walls, nor the flames dancing among the fragrant oils they held.
"Don't you have a word for prince in Egypt?" she asked him.
"A prince is a king's son."
"Well, I'm that certainly," he said with a sudden bravado that made Tadu Keeper smile.
Then he ducked his head again, as if bashful of his own flare of pride. He gazed down at her while they walked.
"I am the first son of the great king Amunhotep, and heir to his throne. You may call me Tutmos."
"Prince Tutmos," she said,
careful to keep her voice soft and low. She knew that this was a sacred place, even if it was as dark as the underworld.
"King's son, Tutmos,"
he corrected gently, forming the Hurrian words with care.
"In Egypt, all status, all power derives from the king. It is your relation to the pharaoh that determines your standing. A prince is not a man of power in his own right. He is only great because he is a king's son. And so you see, even a minor king's wife, as you are, stands high above the most beautiful ladies of the court. That is the soil from which Nefertiti's mockery springs. You forgive her, won't you?"
"Of course."
They walked on in silence for a few paces more. Tadu Keeper watched the flames dance in the braziers and saw how the light picked out the crevices and curves of old carvings, darkened by generations of incense, the long, powerful legs of gods, the dipping, dancing arms of goddesses, and the prostrate forms of worshippers seemed to descend down the temple's walls, slinking into rings of lamplight, which stretched and flickered upward to meet them.
"Nefertiti has double cause to envy you," Tutmos continued. "You come to us a king's wife, and you are even a king's daughter, though the king of Mitanni holds little power in our court. Yet for all her beauty, yes, I saw how you stared at her, Nefertiti has no real standing." He gave a little chuckle, then added, "Not yet, at any rate. She and I will be married soon, and one day when my father's well-earned rest is at hand, I'll be the pharaoh. Nefertiti will be satisfied then, I dare say."
"She is lucky," Tadu Keeper said, flushing at her own audacity, "to have such a kind and courteous husband."
Thutmose patted her hand where it rested in the crook of his elbow, a familiar gesture, as if they had known one another since childhood. You mustn't let her teasing disturb you. Nefertiti is kind and good, I swear it, when you get to know her. At last they reached the inner sanctum of the temple. Here the burning bowls of oil were plentiful and illuminated a rough half-circle of men and women dressed in the long flowing linens and jeweled ornaments of nobility. They conversed quietly in small groups, and servants moved about the crowd, offering cups of chilled wine and bowls of dates and spiced nuts, refreshments against the heat outside. The air was one of subdued festivity, balanced by reverence for the temple. As Thutmose and Tadukipa approached the crowd, several of the nobles turned toward them and fell silent. Nefertiti, standing out in their midst like a lily among plain brown grasses, offered Tadukipa a soft smile that held none of her earlier mockery. Beyond the waiting crowd, two great sets of double doors stood waiting, recessed into the temple's wall. Both were carved with images of Amun, the Egyptian sun god. The doors were leafed from top to bottom in bright yellow gold and set with several rows of polished stones. Even in the fitful lamplight, the doors sparkled, and Tadukipa inhaled sharply at the sight. There was more wealth displayed on those doors than an entire farming district of Mitanni could produce in 3 months. She had come to a land of gods and spirits indeed. Come, Thutmose said. He led her through the crowd. She could feel the eyes of the nobles following her, assessing her, taking in her long, heavy robes and the sweat that still beaded along her brow, noting the fear on her pale, wide-eyed face. Thutmose halted beside one set of doors, the smaller of the two, and tapped lightly on its frame. A moment later, it swung open, creaking on its hinges. The chamber within was darker still, a dense black, which not even the closest lamps could penetrate. You may go in, Thutmose said. Tadukipa balked. It's quite all right, he assured her. Your audience will be short, and then we'll proceed with the marriage. He added in a whisper that only she could hear. There is nothing to fear. Tadukipa felt a surge of gratitude for his discretion, but still she hesitated, staring into the core of black. Nan stepped quickly to Tadukipa's side. I'll go first, lady, she said, and although Tadukipa could see how she trembled, the servant walked into the blackness without hesitation. Before she could lose what little courage still remained to her, Tadukipa followed. She reached out, groping for Nan's hand as Thutmose shut the door behind them. Why is everything so dark here? Tadukipa whispered. It's unnatural. She heard the soft rustle of unseen servants in the darkness, silent, accustomed to the black, waiting at their ease like birds in a nighttime roost. Then the squeal of another door sounded somewhere ahead. A pool of coppery light spilled from a doorway into the chamber where Tadukipa stood. The lamp was carried by a man, perhaps 30 years in age, with a simple white kilt and an unadorned chin-length wig, a style Tadukipa had seen at the Mitanni court on stewards from Egypt. These were, she knew, the men who did the bidding of the Pharaoh and his most favoured nobles. A figure moved behind the steward, small and delicate of proportion, but not a child. This one had the unmistakable poise, the confident, easy grace of a royal woman. As she and her steward came forward, the woman shifted in and out of the lamp's reach, now revealed, now cloaked again in shadow. Tadukipa caught glimpses of her face and form, fragmented impressions like fish darting in the shallows of a lake. The small woman had a dark complexion, and her face was lined by late middle age, especially around the mouth, which seemed to frown more naturally than it smiled. The skin of her cheeks and neck had just begun to sag, but in the brief flashes Tadukipa could see, and in spite of her cool, unamused expression, the woman still held a stark sort of beauty, reminiscent of a mountain's stony peak. The pleats of a blue gown stirred in the breeze of her brisk pace, and resting atop her intricate wig, she carried with practiced ease the weight of a tall, ornate crown, two high golden plumes rising from a gilded sun disk. The steward stepped aside, holding his lamp before him. The small, aging woman halted in the ring of light. The folds of her gown swung and settled about her feet. She stared at Tadukipa silently, expressionless, save for the scowl that was evidently hers by nature. Nan shifted uncomfortably. Tadukipa gripped her hand harder, desperate for reassurance.
"What should I do?"
she breathed. Nan began.
"Perhaps..."
But the stately woman said in a clear, powerful voice, in her own language. "Do you have our tongue?" The Egyptian she had worked so hard to learn flooded back into Tadukipa's mind. Relief washed over her. She sent up a tiny prayer to Ishtar in thanks for this one small mercy.
"Yes, mistress,"
she answered. "Good." The woman came forward a few steps. Though slight of frame, she nevertheless bore a palpable force of personality. It preceded her, like a perfume or an aura, sweeping across the room in advance of her stride, so that she seemed to grow in size as she closed in on Tadukipa, until the fact of her presence towered over the Princess of Mitanni, like the cold, blocky gates of the temple precinct. Instinctively, Tadukipa lowered her eyes, then dropped her chin. She would have sunk into a trembling bow, but the woman's hand flashed out, small and frail-looking, yet so precise in its movement, and a single finger caught Tadukipa beneath her chin. The finger was as hard as iron. It pressed irresistibly upward until Tadukipa's head was tilted back, held at an arrogant, uncomfortable angle. In the silence, she could hear the wick of the steward's lamp crackle, and she swallowed once, her throat as tight as a stretched thread. "You are the king's wife now," the woman said. Her voice filled the room, though she did not shout. She had no need of shouting. "Queen," she said in Hurrian, so there could be no mistaking her meaning. Then she resumed in Egyptian. "You are not a concubine, nor the wife of a mere noble. You hold your head up proudly. You do not lower your eyes. Do you understand?"
"Yes, mistress,"
Tadukipa managed. With her head stretched back, her voice was nothing but a dry breath. The finger flashed away, and Tadukipa inhaled in relief, lowering her chin a fraction, resisting the urge to rub at her neck. "You must call me King's Great Wife, or Great Wife," the woman said, not unkindly, but not warmly either, simply informing. Then she added, "Tai."
"I am Tadukipa, daughter of King Tushratta of Mitanni,"
Tadukipa began. But Tai said shortly, "I know," cutting short the speech Tadukipa had rehearsed for her arrival in this new land. "Do you know why you have come, Tadukipa?"
I come because my father has sent me,"
she thought miserably.
"Sent me into exile to suit purposes of his own. And I must now find some place in this strange foreign court, in a land so hot the very sun seems to hate me."
She felt the first sting of tears and blinked hard to clear them from her eyes before Great Wife Tai could notice their shine.
"I come at my father's bidding. He has sacrificed my happiness, and I will never see my home or my mother and sisters again."
She drew a deep breath to steady her heart.
"I come to maintain the critical bond between Egypt and Mitanni."
She was pleased that she managed to say it without a quaver, that she sounded almost as confident as Tai herself. "Yes," Tai replied, "and here you are. Do you know what your father Tushratta has demanded as your price? Statues of his goddess, cast in solid gold." Tadukipa flinched. She had not known that Tushratta demanded a payment, that in spite of her elegant dowry, she had, in the end, been purchased like a sack of grain. Her head drooped again.
"Ah!"
Tai said shortly, a warning. With effort, Tadukipa lifted her chin. "It doesn't matter," Tai told her. Something like warmth creased the corners of her eyes.
"I would have come willingly," Tadukipa said.
In spite of the misgivings she still felt, her anger flared.
"I love my country, my home. I would have come willingly to Egypt to seal the peace to keep Mitanni safe, if only I'd been asked."
This was not true, Tadukipa admitted to herself, but it was a noble ideal. She liked to think that in time she could become that sort of woman, the sort who would sacrifice for the land and the people she loved.
"I will be brave enough one day,"
she said silently.
then it will be true of me.
Instead, Ty prompted,
instead I was sold, like a slave, like a whore.
Ty's dark eyes sharpened. Are you a whore? She asked it very directly, with no hint of coyness, without any of Nefertiti's cultish play. The matter-of-fact question raised Tadukipa's ire. Now there was no need for Ty to remind her to lift her chin.
With respect, great wife Ty,
Tadukipa said coldly.
How dare you ask such a question? I am a virgin, as befits a new bride.
One side of Ty's mouth curled, transforming from its natural frown into a wry, approving smile.
Virgin brides indeed,
she said, nearly laughing. This is Egypt, king's wife. You are a long way from Atani, but it makes no matter. So long as you are devoted to the pharaoh from this day forward, it is all one to me. Whether you were as pure as an uncracked egg, or whether you used to spread your legs for every Hurrian shepherd that came your way. Tadukipa could think of no response to such an outrageous statement. She flushed with anger and was glad that the light was dim. How old are you? Great wife Ty asked.
17.
Young, Ty said. My husband will like that. Tadukipa bit her lip. It had not occurred to her until now that she must share the king with this woman, this sharp, bold, fearsome woman. Surely the pharaoh had other wives, and their status was above that of his vast, unloved collection of lower concubines. Tadukipa now held that same elevated position. Ty must be used to the pharaoh's broad interests, used to sharing the king. Tadukipa devoutly hoped it was true. The petty envy of Nefertiti was a challenge she could learn to handle, given time. But if Ty took it into her head to hate Tadukipa, she felt sure there was nothing she could do to preserve herself from this tiny woman's implacable wrath.
Don't look alarmed, child, Ty said. I'm sure your duties will be light.
The pharaoh is a man of habit, and he is not inclined to alter his routines, even for a pretty face. It was a different story some years back. If you'd come to us then, you would have had a harder time of it. But of late, well, you shall see. Abruptly, Ty sighed, rubbing her forehead with the tips of two fingers. My head aches. Wasit always makes my head ache. The smell, you know, and the crowds. I feel sure the presence of so many people does something foul to the air, poisons it in some way, though the magicians have always told me it isn't so. She turned to her steward. Huya, tell one of my maids to prepare my special wine. The man bobbed a small bow, bending over his lamp. Great wife, I believe all the wine and herbs we brought with us from the West Bank have been used up.
What?
Ty rounded on him. Do those entitled heifers who call themselves my maids drink it all themselves? I shall beat them with my own hand. No, great wife, Huya said smoothly. You drank it all. Last hour, you recall, while we waited for the king's wife, Tadukipa, to arrive. Ty sighed again, like a woman enduring a veritable plague of offences. There is nothing for it, then, but to soldier through. She dusted her hands together, brushing away the prospect of unpleasant work ahead. She said to Tadukipa, once this business is concluded and Armin has approved of your marriage to the pharaoh, we will leave this stinking city, thank the gods.
Leave the city, great wife, Tadukipa said. But where will we go?
To the West Bank, of course. Back to the pharaoh's palace, the house of rejoicing. It's beautiful there, serene and quiet, and it smells sweet. It's so far from the stink of Waset, the air is wholesome. Ty reached out and took Tadukipa's hand. Her fingers were hard and cold, her nails as sharp as the gripping talons of a falcon. But Tadukipa sensed that the great wife meant the gesture kindly. You will like the House of Rejoicing, you'll see. But until we are back there, in our sanctuary, you and I must both soldier through.
What do you mean, great wife? Soldier through what?
Ty levelled a dark stare at Tadukipa. The copper lamplight played over her face, forming unsettling, flickering shapes beneath the older woman's eyes. When you see the pharaoh, your husband, you must not show any distaste. Misgiving filled Tadukipa, curdling her stomach.
Distaste?
She stammered. A gentle tap sounded on the door. The Pharaoh has arrived, Tutmose's deep voice said, muffled by the door's thickness. He is in Amun's sanctuary. All is ready. Show no distaste, Tai said again, and led Tadu Keeper by the hand, out of their chamber and into the circle of waiting nobility. The courtiers bowed low as Tai swept past. They held their hands up, palms facing the great royal wife. Tadu Keeper was obliged to stride quickly to keep up. Tai was small-framed, but moved with a directness and purpose that could have left a large man panting in her wake. Tadu Keeper held her thick, heavy skirts well clear of her ankles and thanked the goddess that she did not break into a fresh sweat. The crowd of nobles remained bent in their postures of obeisance until Tai barked, "Rise!" The second set of doors, the larger of the two, swung wide. Lamplight flashed off the tall, strong, gilded carvings of the god Amun, rippling like streams of a fountain over bands of lapis lazuli and malachite. Nan whispered a few hurrying words to the Mitanni servants who bore Ishtar carefully between them. The crowd seemed to draw itself in, like a single body, taking one expectant breath, and then Tai led the way into the god's sanctuary. A cloud of perfumed smoke spilled from the doorway, rising at once into the black heights of the temple. It was lulling and sweet, rich with myrrh, Amun's favorite scent. The low rhythmic voices of women followed the incense, twisting and flowing, like the smoke clouds themselves. As she stepped into the sanctuary, Tadu Keeper could see that each chanting woman, there was perhaps a dozen of them arrayed in a half circle, was dressed in a simple white linen robe, tied at the waist with an unadorned sash of blue. Each held a tiny oil lamp in her hands. The flames illuminated the undersides of their faces, so that proportion and perspective were thrown out of balance, and the women appeared to hover like spirits in the darkness. Their mouths seemed to open and close without regard to the rhythm of their song. The little oil lamp spilled just enough light that Tadu Keeper could make out the faint outlines of Amun himself, Egypt's lord of the sun, who, she had learned, paradoxically preferred to remain cloaked in darkness. He was slightly larger than a mortal man, and sat steady and straight upon his throne, his face turned toward the double doors, though in the darkness, Tadu Keeper could discern nothing of his features. The sparse light was just enough to limn his square shoulders, his confident posture, and the two enormous plumes rising from his crown, not unlike the plumes great wife Tai wore. There was a rustle in the darkness behind Tadu Keeper, the crowd of Egyptians bowing once more, offering their palms to the statue of Amun. She did the same, and heard Tai give a little hum of approval. As she straightened, Tadu Keeper heard a grunt, followed by a thick sigh. It came from somewhere near the foot of the statue, but in the darkness she could not determine its source. Once more, Tai took Tadu Keeper's hand and pulled the princess closer still to the sun god. It was only then that she saw the Pharaoh. Amenhotep sat hunched in a chair, shrouded in the shadows that gathered around the statue's feet. His trembling hands were braced on the chair's arms. He grunted and puffed again, struggling to rise from his seat. In the dim light, Tadu Keeper took in the great belly that pushed over the top of his white kilt, the sickly pallor of his skin, the mottled face with its sagging jowls swaying between the locks of his wig. He wore the double crown, towering red and white. But as he struggled, the crown tipped precariously, and with a muttered curse he steadied it with one age-spotted hand. "You should remain seated," Tai said smoothly, going to him, easing him back gently with one hand on his shoulder. "You are the lord of Waset. There is no need to rise if you do not wish it."
"Nonsense,"
Amenhotep said thickly. He made another effort, levering himself carefully against the throne's arms, and at last he rose ponderously to his feet. Now Tadu Keeper understood what Tai had meant. Show no distaste. The Pharaoh Amenhotep was draped with folds of fat, his flesh softened and overfed from too many years of royal excess and too few years on the battlefield. He was a man of advanced age, but not yet so old that he ought to find such great difficulty in rising. It could only be his bulk that hindered him so, and his indolence, which was evident in the heavy-lidded laze of his eyes. Below the scent of Amun's copious myrrh, Tadu Keeper detected the faintest trace of sourness rising from the pharaoh's body. The odor held a suggestion of danger, of disease. She understood at once that quite apart from his astounding heaviness, the king of Egypt was ill, perhaps seriously so. She bowed low once more, holding out her palms in supplication, grateful that in this position the pharaoh could not see the look of shock and disgust on her face. But in only a moment his dry, warm hand closed on hers, and Tadukeeper straightened and made herself look calmly into his eyes.
"I welcome you to Egypt, wife,"
the pharaoh said.
"You are as beautiful as your father, King Tushratta, promised."
"And even as a queen, I shall be locked away in the harem, to wither and die of loneliness," she thought with a stab of desolate pain. It was certain that a man in such a state would have no real interest in a new wife. Tadukeeper resisted the urge to glance toward Prince Thutmose. She did not desire the pharaoh. He was nothing at all like his beautiful courtly son. But she might have hoped at least for a child to ease the years of loneliness and confinement that lay ahead of her. There was no question, though, that Amenhotep could not sire a child on her, even if he possessed the inclination to try. A man in his condition was surely devoid of fertile seed, and probably devoid of the energy to go planting in any wife's field. She hadn't even motherhood to hope for. Despair drew around her, like the folds of a thick woolen cloak. But she felt Great Wife Tai's gaze upon her face, so Tadukeeper made herself smile.
"I thank you for your graciousness, mighty Horus," she told him softly. "I am pleased that you have chosen me, and hope to make both Mitanni and Egypt proud."
The pharaoh nodded.
"I have brought Ishtar," she added, gesturing to the servants beside her, who held the statue of the goddess up so that the holy lady might examine and commune with her fellow deity, Amun. "My father sends her with his blessings for you, and his hope that she might extend her healing powers over you."
"Very thoughtful,"
Amenhotep said, and Tadukeeper could read neither dryness nor gratitude in his voice. The chanting women concluded their song. Silence enveloped the dark shrine. A bald-headed priest emerged from the shadows behind Amun's throne, the skin of a leopard slung over his shoulder. He carried a small bowl in one hand, a tiny vial in the other. Both objects were carved from pure, thin alabaster and seemed to glow in the light of the lamps. The priest offered both vessels to Amenhotep. The pharaoh took a pinch of salt from the bowl, and Tadukeeper, well-schooled in Egyptian marriage customs, turned her face toward him and opened her mouth. She closed her eyes so that she could not see the king's plump, sallow fingers approaching. When the bitter grains of salt dropped upon her tongue, she swallowed hard to keep from gagging.
"With salt I feed thee," Amenhotep said.
Next he accepted the white stone vial and raised it over Tadukeeper's head. Warm, fragrant oil pattered against her hair, trickling down to mingle with the sweat on her scalp.
"With oil I anoint thee."
Tadukeeper stood with her chin raised, as Tai had bidden, while the high priest of Amun recited a long poetic litany of praise to the sun god. Then he called down Amun's blessing upon the union, and asked the god to favor Tadukeeper's womb, that it might bring forth many healthy children. At this she stifled the laugh that clawed at the back of her throat. It felt hysterical, wild, desperate. She blinked hard, forgetting the foreign tongue she had studied, allowing the priest's words to blur into a mess of meaningless sound. Tadukeeper had come to Egypt a virgin, and a virgin she was likely to remain. Finally, the gathering paused, waiting in the darkness to hear whether the god's golden statue would speak, whether he would offer any condemnation on the union, or lay a curse that would shatter this marriage before it had even begun. Tadukeeper allowed a foolish hope to spark in her breast, but all too soon the high priest raised his hands in benediction and pronounced the marriage acceptable to the gods.
"Go now and celebrate,"
he said, and as one the gathering bowed before Amun. No one saw the two small tears that slipped down Tadukeeper's cheeks, falling silently on the cold tiles of the sanctuary floor. It took an hour for the procession of noblemen and their gaily dressed wives to make its way back to the heart of the city, through its finer districts, and on down to the quay, where a fleet of glorious pleasure barks waited. The barks' bright pennants flapped in the breeze, and the gold-leafed eyes adorning their bows seemed to blink as the boats bobbed on the river's gentle current. Wine and strong beer appeared like mushrooms after a Mitanni rain, and skins and jugs were passed from hand to hand among the celebrating crowd. Throughout the revelries, Tadu Keeper remained silent and placid-faced on her litter, sitting as still as Ishtar beside her. She watched the rear of Amenhotep's huge electrum-plated carrying chair as it progressed slowly before her, borne on the backs of 16 broad-shouldered men. Not once did the pharaoh deign to look around, to catch sight of his new bride in the sunlight. He only slumped in his seat, his body stirring faintly with the thick rhythm of his breath, while Tai on her own litter moved smoothly beside the king, like a boat drifting on a current, observing the revelries with a detached and unreadable stare. When at last the singing, laughing crowds filtered onto the pleasure barks and Tadu Keeper herself was conducted aboard a small private boat with a few of her Mitanni servants, she crept into the shelter of a curtained cabin, taking only Nan with her. Nan drew the heavy drapes tight and turned to Tadu Keeper with her mouth hanging open, a look of sorrowful disbelief painted on her pale features. Tadu Keeper's chin quivered. She felt as knocked out of place, as wholly gone, as Nan's missing tooth.
"Oh,"
Nan said slowly.
"Mistress, he's horrible,"
Tadu Keeper whispered. She covered her face with trembling hands, wishing Nan couldn't see her weeping, but grateful the serving girl was there.
"He was polite,"
Nan offered. It was a lame attempt at comfort, and Tadu Keeper nearly lashed out at her before she recalled that Nan, too, was condemned to exile, trapped in this terrible place against her will or whim.
"We only have one another,"
Tadu Keeper said. With a strangled sob, Nan rushed toward her. They clung together, burying their faces in each other's hair. Tadu Keeper breathed deep, tasting the last final traces of Mitanni in Nan's scent. The green fragrance of the coasts, the softness of spring flowers, the sacred smoke of sandalwood. Soon, she knew, those memories would fade.
"You must be brave,"
Nan said, her voice muffled by Tadu Keeper's shoulder.
"You must bear up and be a true queen. It's all you can do now."
"I know," Tadu Keeper said. The sailors on deck shouted and cast off their boat's lines. The gilded bark pushed out into the great grey-brown river, shuddering lightly in the grip of the current. But Tadu Keeper did not peek from her curtained enclave, did not join her servants on deck to watch as Waset shrunk to a grimy dot on the eastern bank, and the bright glowing walls of the House of Rejoicing grew larger to the west. Instead, the two girls threw themselves down on the scattered silk cushions, locked in one another's arms, weeping for the world they would never see again. Nefertiti, year 36 of Amenhotep, ruler of Waset, lord of truth in the sun, strong bull arising. It was dawn before Nefertiti returned to her father's estate. She crossed the lanes of the west bank in blissful silence as the sun rose to fill the sky with a rose petal blush. Her train of servants followed behind, yawning and shuffling. The light of a fresh new day crept up the street, a slow but inevitable flow like honey pouring from a jar. Everything it touched was tinted with warmth. Nefertiti held up one smooth, elegant hand as she walked and examined it in the glow of dawn. Even her skin was touched by a golden hue, just like the skin of a goddess. Apt, she thought. How perfectly perfect. The wedding feast celebrating Amenhotep's union with the Hurrian foreigner had stretched into the late hours. The ailing pharaoh had begun to look pale and afflicted well before the second course, and had taken his leave midway through the third. Great wife Tai and her perpetual frown exited with him. The pharaoh had turned over the seat of honor to Thutmose, his heir, and Nefertiti, as Thutmose betrothed, had settled herself to the left of the throne. She had enjoyed the view from the dais, raised above the heads of the West Bank nobles, those considered important enough, grand enough, of high enough birth to live near the king and his house of rejoicing, buffered from the stink and lowly clamour of Waset by the wide, grey-green expanse of the river Iteru. Few experiences had pleased Nefertiti as much as the simple act of sitting so high above the best and wealthiest families in the two lands. The dais, the throne, was where she belonged. She had felt the certainty of it coiled tight inside her, like a bud on the verge of bursting open. That gloried elevation was what she had been preparing for nearly her whole life, or rather it was what her father had been preparing her for. Throughout her 18 years, there had been many times, uncountable times, when Nefertiti had felt convinced she would never attain the status she wanted, the greatness for which she had been groomed, when her fingers went awry on her harp strings and her tutor scolded, when her voice broke as she sang, when her sister Moot Benret cried out from the sting of the cane because yet again Nefertiti had been caught walking gracelessly through the halls, or because their father, Ai, had seen a defiant flash in Nefertiti's eyes. But at last she had found herself there, seated on the golden chair and raised above them all, even her father, as a great king's wife ought to be. She was untouchable on the dais, and all the eyes of Egypt were upon her. Of course, Nefertiti was not great wife yet. She would not be raised to that exalted status until she and Thutmose were married, and old fat Amenhotep finally went down into his tomb. It won't be long now. Nefertiti mused comfortably as she strolled from the House of Rejoicing to her father's estate. The current pharaoh, weakened by the day, plagued by pains in his teeth that spread and throbbed through the bones of his face, or so the servant's gossip said. He looked so powerless now, a wilted petal from some waxen yellow bloom, that it felt obscene to even think of him as king. Time to make way for my betrothed, my beloved, for a strong young king who can be the demigod a pharaoh must be. She imagined Thutmose back in the House of Rejoicing, reclining on his cedar and ivory bed where she had left him. By now the light of dawn would be slanting through his window, falling on his bare skin, turning him to gold too, like the god he was inside. We are all gods here, she thought. We hold ourselves apart from the rabble, the East Bank racket with their low blood, who mill like cattle and bleat like the senseless goats of the fields. Long before Nefertiti was born, the pharaoh left the dull, mortal-fleshed city of Waset behind and established his court across the river. Better, far better this way. What commoner would dare to approach this shining new city of the pharaoh? Only the chosen dwelt here, the well-bred, the valuable, the pure. West was the direction of death, the direction in which the sun died at the close of each day, the direction in which the tombs lay, those cold, dark, stale-aired chambers bored into the rocky bones of the earth. The House of Rejoicing and the estates that surrounded it, homes of those family chosen by the king himself, existed like a veil between worlds, an ethereal place hanging between the living and the glorious immortal dead. Egypt's most noble families drifted here like mist above the water, set apart, untouchable and more beautiful than any mortal heart could comprehend. She was one of the lucky ones, Nefertiti knew. The gods could have caused her to be born into any other family. They could have made her the child of wrecked farmers, scrabbling in the black Etiru mud for her livelihood, whelping litters of young in the fields just like any common beast bred for the harness. But the gods were good. They had made her this, daughter of a famed charioteer who had risen to the king's closest favor, niece of the king's great wife, betrothed to the heir to the Horus throne, and beautiful as the sun rising, and golden as the goddess she would soon become. The lanes of the West Bank stirred slowly to wakefulness as the servants of the noble houses rose to their morning tasks. She heard the quiet conversation of women drawing water from a canal, the metallic chip-chip-chip of two fire flints struck together in the seclusion of an estate's walled courtyard. Soon the outdoor ovens would be lit, and the gardens would fill with the sweet, tempting odor of baking bread. For now, the morning still clung to the crisp perfume of dew and well-watered greenery, and Nefertiti could still smell Thutmose, his compelling scent of musk and myrrh clinging to her skin. How pleasant it was to drift down the lanes of the West Bank, alone but for her sleepy servants. How good of the gods to make Nefertiti what she was, to fit her into this time and this place, smooth and easy, and just so. Like a carpenter fitting a peg into a piece of fine ebony wood furniture. In the days before Amenhotep had taken his court west to dwell in this vale between the worlds, she would have been obliged to go everywhere with an escort of guards, or carried on a litter, as she was for yesterday's wedding procession to and from the Temple of Amun. In Waset, and elsewhere, everywhere in the two lands, the world was not a gentle place. But here, where the homes of the blessed and precious clustered around the House of Rejoicing, like chicks around a she-goose, there was nothing to fear. She was safe. She was always safe. Nefertiti turned onto the path that led to her father's gate. Her servants sighed with relief. It had been a long night for them, for her too, though she would not have had it any other way. She was 18 years old. At that age, life itself is one great extended celebration, full of song and dance and endless displays of beauty. When a woman is young and beautiful, she can taste every dish life sets before her, drink from every cup, and never stop to sleep, never pause for rest. What good is sleep when it only interrupts the pleasures of the waking world? The porter opened the gate when Nefertiti's maid rang the bell, bowing low when he saw the young mistress standing there in her rumpled red linen gown. The long curled locks of her wig matted and disarrayed from the fragrant beeswax sticking to its black strands. The wax had been a festive white cone at the beginning of the feast, tied carefully to her wig like a little crown of alabaster. As the night wore on, and the feast hall grew hotter with the presence of so many bodies, and with Tutmose's enticing proximity, it had softened, then melted drip by drip to fill the air around Nefertiti with the intoxicating scent of night-blooming jasmine. The porter bowed and stood back for her to enter. Nefertiti breezed into the courtyard, brushing past the household servants who busied themselves with the ovens and pans of risen bread dough. "Go to your chambers and rest," she called over her shoulder, to her own train of attendants, and gratefully her servants scattered. The courtyard gave way to a portico, the space between its pillars retaining the river-damp coolness of the night. Her gold-threaded sandals tapped lightly on the paving stones. The vines thriving in the shade brushed her cheek with leaves like long, soft fingers. Beyond the portico was the entrance of Ai's fine two-story house, its doors flung open so the servants might bustle back and forth between courtyard and hall unimpeded. Nefertiti slipped in easily. It seemed her father and her stepmother, Lady Taya, were still asleep, and climbed the stairs to her chamber. But before she could reach her chamber, Moot Benret's face, still round with the last traces of childhood, peered from the alcove that hid the entrance to her own room. "You're back," Moot Benret called softly. Nefertiti smiled. "Of course I'm back, silly duck. Would I stay all night and day too? Eventually even the House of Rejoicing becomes a bore." Moot Benret took a hesitant step down the hall, hands clasped at her waist. "Well, come on," Nefertiti said, pushing open her chamber door. "I know you're dying to hear all about it. All about the party, the late-night revelries, the entertainments, both planned and unplanned, that were offered when the hours grew late and the wedding feast stretched on into the deep of the night." Moot Benret had been obliged to leave with Ai and Lady Taya when they'd had their fill of the feast. It was just as well, Nefertiti thought. The late-night celebrations were nothing for a girl of 11 to see, and any girl as compliant as Moot Benret, as used to doing what she was told without question or complaint, might get into trouble at such a wild carousal. Parties became truly good when the older nobles trickled off to their beds, and the young and adventurous were left to steer the boat where it most wanted to go. Nefertiti sank onto her bed, sighing. The night had been exhausting after all. She could still feel its heat and frantic rhythms pulsing along her limbs. A nap before breakfast would be welcome. But first she must tell her little sister everything. The day would soon come when Moot Benret would be allowed to remain at a feast after I departed, and the girl must know what to expect. She held out one arm, and Moot Benret came to her eagerly, tucking herself against Nefertiti's body, resting her shaven head with its youthful braided side lock on Nefertiti's shoulder. "The music became loud and wild just after you and father and your mother left," Nefertiti said. "It was like the baying of hounds. It made all the handsome young men eager for a hunt." "A hunt?" said Moot Benret, smiling lightly. "You know, I've told you all about that." Nefertiti pulled the wax-covered wig from her head and tossed it across the room. It missed her cedarwood wig stand by several feet and landed on the floor with a comical smack. Both girls giggled.
"But it's always best to let any hunter dream of his prey before he goes prowling," Nefertiti went on. "It makes him sharper and keener, and the sport is so much better that way."
Moot Benret nodded sagely, as if she were wise in the ways of men. When the seventh course came out from the kitchens, it was followed by a troop of naked acrobats, male and female. Their displays left little room for imagination. Nefertiti gave a short, sharp laugh, which made her sister sit up and peer inquiringly at her face. The Harian, the new king's wife, was mortified by the acrobats. I could see it on her face. She had asked leave of the Pharaoh to remain at the feast when he and great wife Ty departed. Poor dear. I think she was trying to avoid consummating her marriage, though the gods know Amenhotep is in no state to lie with a woman. I don't blame her. If I were married to a man of his size, and in such poor health, I'd avoid my marriage bed too.
He would crush his wife before he could beget a child. You shouldn't say such things about the Pharaoh,
Moot Benret said, tensing as if she expected punishment from some unseen watcher.
Oh, but it's only the truth. The gods were merciful to me. They promised me to Tutmose.
Nefertiti slitted her eyes, smiling dreamily. It's hard to believe a man as handsome and vigorous as Tutmose was sired by Amenhotep. Ah, well, the poor Hurrian girl. When she saw the acrobats bending and twisting around one another, naked as they were, I believe she regretted her choice to stay in the hall. You know how prudish foreigners can be. But what a choice! Stay and be embarrassed, or go and be stripped naked before Amenhotep. I wouldn't trade places with the king's wife Kiya for all the riches in the treasury.
Kiya, is that her name?
It's what I call her. A good name, don't you think? Moot Benret frowned. The name meant monkey in the Egyptian tongue.
I hope you were kind to her, Nefertiti. She's so far from her home.
Of course I was kind, my sweet, soft-hearted little sister. She remained up on the dais with Tutmose and me, and we were both very solicitous and thoughtful. We gave her first choice of all the dishes that were presented, though I think by the time you left the feast hall, she was quite stuffed like a goose ready for roasting, and she didn't eat much more. Her Egyptian is quite good, I must admit. She has a funny accent, but she speaks the language well enough. She even told a few amusing stories and made Tutmose laugh. She paused.
Did you see me up there, sitting on the dais, right beside the Pharaoh's throne? How could I not see you? The whole banquet hall saw. You looked finer than any king's great wife who has ever lived.
Finer than Ty? Moot Benret gave a shy laugh.
Auntie Sourface.
Then her eyes darted around Nefertiti's chamber, as if she were afraid the walls might be listening.
Auntie Sourface was a spectacular beauty in her younger days, Nefertiti said.
Father always says so. She won the Pharaoh's heart with her beauty, he says, but kept her place with her wits. Nefertiti tossed her head. Her natural hair, dark and curly, and tightly bound in a roll against her nape, lay flattened on her scalp from long hours spent beneath the heavy wax-laden wig. I meant to take a lesson from that, I suppose. But I'm glad I didn't have to win any Pharaoh's heart. Not that I couldn't rise to the task.
It's better this way. Promise to Tutmose, with everything planned out in advance. And now we need only wait for the gods to call Amenhotep to the west. When he dies, I'll be king's great wife. Out of all the women in Egypt, just think of it, Moot Benret. Your own sister, wife of the Pharaoh.
The younger girl smiled faintly.
You looked a natural up there, sitting beside the throne. It's where the gods intend you to be.
Nefertiti wrapped her half-sister in a tight embrace.
It will all be worth it then, everything we've suffered.
Though Nefertiti knew well that Moot Benret had suffered far more than she.
We'll be free from all these expectations, all these rules, the training, the watching, the punishments.
Oh yes, we. I'll take you with me to the House of Rejoicing, and Father will remain here, simmering behind his walls like a soggy old dumpling. Moot Benret pulled away, eyeing Nefertiti with doubt.
I'll be the king's great wife.
Nefertiti said, perhaps a bit too forcefully. I'll be the one in charge, of everyone, of all the two lands. That includes father. He'll have to do what I say, and I'll put a stop to everything. You'll be safe, Moot Benred. I swear it. We have only to wait a little while longer. Soon, Thutmose will be Pharaoh, and I'll be his wife, and then you'll see. Tell me more about the feast, Moot Benred said. Her smile was hazy, distant, and Nefertiti could tell that she didn't believe anything would really change when Nefertiti took her place in the king's palace. Perhaps the poor girl couldn't allow herself to believe. The gods could be whimsical and cruel in their caprices. Even a child as young as Moot Benred knew that much. Maybe, Nefertiti thought, the girl is wise to temper her hope. Nefertiti spoke on, telling all she could remember of the night's lush details. The dancers with their gauzy costumes, their wrists and throats glinting in the lamplight with bangles of turquoise and gold, the decadent sweet courses of sugared figs and lemon juice and rose petals crisped in honey. The jests the young men made down among the lower tables, their mock battles for the hearts of ladies, fought with duck bones and the long pale spears of radish roots instead of swords and daggers. She told of fleeting romances that lived and died in the shadows of pillars, all in the space of a few moments, the courtship of whispers, the victorious kiss, the slap across the face, the furious woman striding away with her rumpled dress hanging askew. The music had changed as the night wore on, altering itself subtly, one song at a time, until the harpist no longer plucked ballads from their strings, but darker, more compelling rhythms, throbbing and low. The wind had changed several hours before sunrise, carrying the wet, fertile scent of the garden indoors, where it twined quietly with the savory, spicy odors of the feast and the perfume of women's half-melted waxen crowns. The garden beckoned to young lovers, and two by two they slipped outside to allow themselves to fall under the spell of moonlight and stars. Nefertiti trailed off here, remembering. She no longer felt Moot Benret's slight frame tucked against her. She felt only Thutmose, his arm around her shoulder, guiding her toward the garden, the hard slab of his muscular side, his body as well-trained as any general's, and the slight twist, the shifting of his ribs as he turned to glance back into the hall at the empty pharaoh's throne, and the little Hurrian bride who sat beside it, huddled in her dark woolen robes, staring dull-eyed into the rising, pulsing chaos of the feast. He led Nefertiti out into the fresh night air. It worked its way beneath her wig curls, teasing the back of her neck with a breath of coolness that raised a delicious shiver along her skin. He kissed her there, on the garden path, his tongue forceful in her mouth, his hands ardent on her hips and the soft swell of her behind. Anyone could have seen, several people likely did, though Nefertiti kept her eyes tight shut. She blushed with mingled pleasure and shame at the thought of revelers catching sight of the heir and his betrothed, displaying their passion in such an undignified way. She broke from Thutmose's kiss with an effort, panting out her protests. Not here! Not where everyone can see! Although she made no move to disentangle herself from his arms. In short order, he pulled her into one of the flower beds, where a wall of shrubbery, just high enough to hide them both from immediate view, provided a rather flimsy screen. He backed her up against the thick trunk of a sycamore and pulled her gown up around her hips, lifting her easily to lock her legs around his waist. Nefertiti could still feel the tree's rough bark biting into her shoulders, rotting in the garden, just like a wrecked slut. What would her father say if he knew? The memory made Nefertiti shiver with bliss, but her shiver quickly changed to a shudder of disgust as Thutmose worked steadily, driving Nefertiti back against the tree, while the moonlight and indigo shadow of the leaves dappled across his shoulder. A crackle in the nearby shrubbery made Nefertiti glance around sharply. A man had pushed through the screen of foliage and stood watching them, a small, coolly amused smile on his fleshy lips. Nefertiti nearly screamed until she recognized Thutmose's brother. Stop! She panted in Thutmose's ear. Stop! Reluctantly, Thutmose slowed his efforts, then eased Nefertiti down until she could get her feet beneath her and stand. She couldn't straighten her gown quickly enough. She felt the dark gaze of young Amenhotep, Thutmose's strange, eerily watchful brother, slide over her bare skin. Tutmos turned to find Amenhotep standing there. "Gods!" he shouted, lunging at his brother. "Get out, you rat! You dog!" Unperturbed, Amenhotep took an easy step back, out of the range of Tutmos's swinging fist. The black leaves of the nighttime garden framed his face like a lion's mane. "Dog," Amenhotep had said. His voice was slow, lazy, with a musical smoothness that would have been pleasant in another man. A laugh rippled his words, like a sluggish, muddy current. "Dogs always come sniffing when they hear a bitch in heat." Then he raised his voice.
"Yee, yee, yee!"
yipping in rhythmic imitation of Nefertiti's passionate cries. His teeth flashed pale in the starlight. Tutmos lunged at him again, and laughing, young Amenhotep melted into the shadows of the garden. Tutmos turned back to Nefertiti then, shaking his head and growling. "That foul creature! That blight! I wish Father would send him to the army for training, and that a spear would miss its mark and land on his guts instead." Nefertiti said nothing. Amenhotep departed without raising any further trouble, and the relief that he was gone now flooded her limbs, making her tremble with a violence that surprised her. Tutmos returned to her then, kissing her neck, moving the locks of her wig aside to tease her earlobe with his tongue. But she pushed him away.
"No, not here," she insisted. "What if your brother comes back?"
Tutmos clicked his tongue in annoyance.
"Where then?"
"Your chambers. We can bar the door there and be certain Amenhotep won't come spying." They remained in Tutmos's chambers, tangled in the cool sheets of his wide leopard-legged bed, until it was finally time for Nefertiti to locate her servants and leave the house of rejoicing. Those hours with her betrothed had been sweet, but now in the privacy of her own bedroom, she could recall almost nothing of the time she had spent there. All she could remember with any clarity was young Amenhotep in the garden, his long, leering face melting into the shadows, his eyes sweeping her naked flesh, his teeth gleaming and predatory when he laughed. Moot Benret sensed Nefertiti's discomfiture. "What's the matter?" she asked, sitting up and once more staring in earnest concern. Nefertiti made herself smile lightly. "I was only thinking of the time I spent with Tutmos when we took leave of the feast."
"And what did you do together?"
"Tried to fill my belly, of course," Nefertiti said archly. "Don't you think it would be splendid for Tutmos to begin his reign as Pharaoh, with a son and heir already in the cradle?"
"I suppose."
"When the old Pharaoh dies, Tutmos will inherit more than just the Horus throne, you know. He'll gain all his father's harems as well. Imagine all those palaces and estates just brimming over with women. Any of them might bear a son to Tutmos. I'm not fool enough to believe he'll only ever desire my bed. You know how fickle men can be. I need to get the jump on the harem girls, don't I? The faster I can produce a son, the more secure I'll be on the throne of the king's great wife. But gods grant I never have a son like young Amenhotep," Nefertiti thought. With his alienating silence and intensely watchful eyes, the pharaoh's second eldest son was enough to turn even a mother's heart away. Nefertiti wondered whether her aunt Ty loved her second son, or whether she saw him clearly for what he was. The gods would have been merciful if they'd sent a fever to claim young Amenhotep in the cradle, or made a nurse roll upon him in her sleep, smothering the breath from the child before he'd grown to manhood. As Nefertiti sat in brooding silence, the high light notes of Lady Taya's voice drifted up the stairs and floated down the hall. She was singing in the portico below, as she did at the start of each new day, greeting the god in the form of Capri, the climbing sun of every morning. It was the form of the god which Lady Taya revered the most, for she was ever the optimist.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.